Hello. I'd like to thank you for joining us for Professor Alexander Dugan's continuing Open University lecture series on ethnosociology. Professor Dugan is the chair of the Department of the Sociology of International Relations and the Center for Conservative Studies in the Sociology Faculty of Moscow State University. Today's lecture will focus on the nation. Professor Dugan?
So, now we are going to discuss a second derivative of the ethnos that follows such structure, sociological structure, as the people, Laos, that we have studied in the previous lecture. So, what is the nation and how ethnosociology regards and interprretates it? First of all, I would like to stress one point, that ethnosociology accepts the idea of artificial nature of the nation started by Anderson. The constructivist school in ethnosociology. So there are different vision, different understanding of the nature of the nation. There is a kind of primordialist vision of the nation that tends to interpret the nation as a kind of direct continuation of ethnic unity. So, in primordialist perspective, the modern European nations were continuations of the ethnic societies with the similar names. So, the Germans that formed the German nation in the 19th century were direct descendants from the German-speaking tribes of ancient time, and the people was considered also as the same as the ethnos. So, in primordialist vision, the nation is organic, ethnic society entering in the context of the modernity. In this situation, ethnosociology professes completely opposite vision on the nature of the nation. According to the ethnosociology, nation is artificial construction of special historic situation of the society, organized as a kind of ideology by bourgeois elite in the modernity. So, the nation is considered by the ethnosociology as a completely artificial concept, as a construct that has absolutely nothing to do with the ethnic identity, a little with the people's identity. So, ethnosociology insists on differentiation between three sociological and ethnosociological concepts. The ethnos is organic unity of the society without any traces of social stratification, living in a kind of primordial communism, and this society is not constructed, is organic, is given as a primordial form of human community. So, ethnos is something concrete. The people is the first derivative of ethnos and presupposes at least two ethnic groups superposed one on the other and with highly differentiated social stratification and important social, ethnical, cultural, religious difference between elite and the masses. So the people is not ethnos, but ethnos is preserved in the people on the lower level of the society, on the level of the mass, and at the same time some traces of the ethnic identity we could identify also in elite, but very transformed by the heroic individualization process. Heroic type of the aristocrat. So, we have in people ethnos on the lowest level and the kind of heroic individuality on the level of the elite represented in different archetypal persons as or figures, as for example the king, the prophet, or the philosopher. But the nation is the other social form other than ethnic and than the people. So the nation appears, is manifestos in the history exactly in the moment of creation of modern state and the society where third state, the bourgeois, the citizen of the towns begins to dominate. So, the nation is the absolutely modern phenomenon that is linked to creation of the modern state and completely new form of bourgeois society. The nation is purely bourgeois phenomenon and is inseparable from, we could not separate it from the state, or more precisely from modern state. So in this aspect, Benedict Anderson, who insists that the nation is imagined community, is absolutely right, because he stresses that is purely constructed concept of the organic identity imposed on completely differentiated and individualized citizens that have no more anything in common. So it is a kind of strategy, of ideology, that tries to impose the idea of the organic unity exactly on the society where there is no any traces of organic unity, in order to conserve this individualized, atomized population from the chaotic dissolution or chaotic transformation is something that you cannot govern or rule. So that is a kind of methodology, political methodology, destined to create completely new entity. So that is the nation. The nation is a concept imagined by bourgeois in order to keep the population of the modern state based on the individual citizenship, recognized as such on the level of the law, of the ethic, of the moral, of the vision, of the normative form of society. And in this sense, the nation has absolutely nothing to do with ethnic organic unity of the pre-modern archaic societies or tribe, a little in common with the people, because the people that was in Europe a central form of social organization during Middle Ages, for example, that was characterized by the social stratification and neat differentiation between elite that was in some way super ethnic in its self-consciousness, and the more or less ethnic ethnic masses, but also in the frame of traditional state, of traditional form of religious associations with a unifying structure of the same belongings to the same kind of civilization. So the society in the European Middle Ages was based on the identity of the people. That was the concept of La Os studied by us in the previous lecture. And when there was very important shift in the history from the traditional state to the modern state, from Middle Ages to the modernity, to the completely new time, new epoch with new philosophy, with transformation of any aspect of the social life, there was appearance of completely new social organization that we could define in our chain of the Greek names for different ethnic and post-ethnic derivative, we could define it as demos. So, ethnos, laos, demos. Demos in Greek sense, that was originally the name to call, to define the population of the town, of the city. So that wasn't name for villagers or for the peasants. That was precisely the citizen of the city. And that was demos, and also the demos was a kind of differentiation, division between different area, different localities of the town. So democracy was the form of self-government by the coalition of the representatives of different part of different localities of the ancient city. So, nation is based on the demos, and we could consider that that is the second derivative of ethnos, or the first derivative of the laws, because the nation operating with the concept of demos is continuation of the people's history. At the same time, that is a kind of reverse of the relations that were central hierarchical relations in the people, pretending to be a kind of return to the pre-people's society, to the ethnic society, but not the, really return, because that would presuppose the return to the peasantry, but that the nation and the demos was quite opposite. That was not a figure of the peasant or gatherer or hunter that was obviously in center of the normative anthropologic concept of the demos, but the citizen. So the citizen, etymologically, the citizen, the person living in the city, so bourgeois. And that was considered to be a third state government, or the society organized around the normative person of capitalist, of the bourgeois, of the citizen, of the person who lives in the city. But at the same time, there is very important point to understand the sense and the meaning of this historical shift from traditional society to the modern society, from traditional state to modern state, from people identity to national identity, from Middle Ages to the modernity. In order to understand that correctly, we should explore more the nature of the sociological phenomenon of the city. So, because this city is the central model for creation of modern state, and the citizens, so the person living in the city and not outside of the city, in the villages, these citizens were taken for example, a type or archetype of all society in who. So what is nation? It is the person living in the city, and if by the chance the person doesn't live in the city, he think about himself, he identifies himself with or herself, to be politically correct, identifies himself or herself with the person living in the city. That is the sense of the citizenship. If you are peasant living outside of the city, but if you are citizen of this national state or other national state, so you are normatively considered to be the citizen, so person living in the city, or would be citizen. So that is a kind of norm. The norm not always corresponds to the reality. It is a kind of imposed example to follow, or normal type that is used to be the measure of the society. So, modern state is a kind of big city, is considered to be normatively the big city and its suburbs. So it is a kind enlarged image of the city with the citizens, bourgeois or demos, taking as general archetype of any political identity in the modern state. So the nation was created, the concept of nation was created basing on the sociology of the city. So we need to explore more what were the first cities, first historical towns. That is a kind of widespread error concerning the origins of the city. So idea was that the city is the big village. Nothing is less true. The village can not grow above certain natural limits. The limits when the growing population of the village could not above these limits grant the nurture and they could not afford to take from the earth, from the ambience, natural ambience, more resources to give to it to the population. So when this natural limit of the growth of the population in the village is achieved, so there is always inevitably a kind of migration, a creation of new village in some distance from this village by the descendants of the villagers that have not the possibility to afford the future growth of the families. So when these natural limits are achieved, there is not growth of the village, but creation, migration and creation of new villages. That is a kind of progression of the sedentary civilization, a kind the process of continuous colonization of the peasant world in Europe and in other part of the world as well. So that is interesting that city could not be the great village. The city was from the beginning something different from the village that has grown big or much more than normal village. So that is completely different. And when we begin to study more precisely with more details the histories of the foundation of the new cities, so we see one and the same in any part of the world, one and the same pattern of the origins of the city. The city is created by the warriors as a kind of fortress that is destined to be a military camp for the warriors and the place where the taxes taken from the villagers, from the peasantry, are accumulated. So the city is artificial creation of the warriors. So from the beginning, and the city had completely different meaning than village. The village was destined to produce the goods from the earth and the work on the field in the camp was a kind of destiny for the villagers, for the peasants. And this city was destined to serve as military base with completely different goals. So it was created to defend the strategical point of the space, and from this city to govern all the territories that laid around this city. And also that was a point to gather the taxes taken from the controlled population. So the cities were originally something different from the villages and were special social spaces linked with the exercise of the political power and or with the political domination of the military warriors, elite over masses, living in majority around the city, not in the city. So we could say that this city was originally the place where first and second Indo-European castes, the priests and the warriors, were gathered to exercise their political power over the population. So the city was from origin a kind of superstructure over the space where the majority of the population lived. That was something sacred, something special, and something that was reserved for the highest level of the society. But that gives us first and second castes of the ancient Indo-European society located in the city, and the other population that formed third caste of the Indo-European society, third and not fourth caste, were represented by the people who lived in the villages. So we had three functions in the ancient or traditional society, structured society. So three functions inside of the people, of the people's society, inside of the first derivative of ethics. We had first caste as priests, sacerdotes, the second caste, warriors, and the priests and warriors together formed the nobility, the aristocracy, and third caste, the people who lived on the earth producing natural goods from the peasants. And that is very important key to understand the modernity and the bourgeois as a figure and capitalism as special historic phenomenon. Because third caste or third state in traditional society was peasantry, were peasants, villagers, and not bourgeois. Because the city wasn't in the first epoch the place for the demos, but for the aristocrats. Not for demos, but for higher castes of the traditional society, for the place to go for the priests and for the warriors. And the history of ancient Athens and other Greek cities also show us that that was precisely the origin of this city, because before of creation of stable Demos, the Athens was the place of the warriors or the aristocrats controlling such segment of ethics to come together to decide some military or strategical questions. And in this meeting point were many temples and priests, Greek priests, lived in the same place. So that was a sacred place, and around it also that was a kind of the other second function, the meeting point for local aristocrats. So first and second castes met in this place to decide, to make most important decision concerning whole territory, with the third caste living on the earth. So Athens and Laos didn't know the Demos in the first stages of the traditional society, socially structured, but and differentiated, but traditional society. But that is very important, because we need to consider third state originally not as bourgeois, not as a simple citizen, because there weren't simple citizens in origins of the city. All the citizens weren't simply. It could not be possible to be at the same time citizen and simply citizen. If you are citizen, you are the member of the elites. You are the warrior or the priest or something around him. And the third caste, that was the peasant. But that is the question: how we could understand the modernity and the capitalist society and bourgeois society with the third state in the center of that? How could it be? So, to understand that, we need to concentrate our attention on the economic life of the aristocrats. The aristocrats always were in need of some slaves who would grant to them, who would make for them some technical procedures. So the warrior was surrounded by a group of his vassals, of his slaves, who serve him. And that is very important. The figure of these serve sociologically was not part of the peasantry. Maybe by the provenance, by the origins, they were the descendants of peasants. But finally, they were converted to accomplish in the society a different task and to fulfill different function. So originally, maybe they were peasants, and very rarely they were outcast aristocrats, but they were not warriors. They were not representatives of the priests' caste. So they were a kind, not of third state, but a kind of intermediate social group that served to the aristocrats to grant their the material aspect of their life. So they were, that is very important. And initially, this social group of the slave with only one destiny in life, to serve. So they were the servants. Servants by the nature. Servants by their social identity. The servants who were the part of the army, of the conquerors, of the priests, but at the same time they were not anymore the members of the third caste of the peasants. So their identity was intermediate one between the warriors with their individuality, with their heroic attitude, with their sight in the eyes, directly in the eyes of the death. So the hero is struggling always against the death. He's dealing all his life with the death. The death is the absolute partner of the aristocrat. The priest is dealing with the death on the level of the spirit, or because the priest accomplished the ritual, and the essence of the ritual is killing the victim. So the priest killing the victim and the aristocrat warrior killing the enemy always are dealing with the death. And that was a kind of life to the death, zum Todesein, the being to the death, that was a possibility to see the death as enemy, as something, as a kind of figure that is on the other end of the reality, and the struggle against the death. That was the reason of the kind of reason of the being of the life for the highest castes of traditional society. So they were in continuous struggle, and there was completely different kind of identity, peaceful identity of the peasantry, that was considered to be beyond the death. So the ethnic group, as we have seen in the previous lectures, didn't consider the death as a kind of challenge of bad death, of evil death. The death was a kind of eternal return of the same for the ethnic way of life. So that was the reason why to consider the being as including the death herself as a part of the eternal return of the same. So that gave the kind of peaceful attitude that was characteristic for sedentary agricultural cultures. So we see peaceful peasants and warrior, heroic aristocrats. But what was identity, which was identity of the intermediate group between the warriors and the peasants? They were a kind of hybrids, a kind of monsters, the kind of artificial social type with false consciousness from the beginning, because they were dealing with the power and the death on the side of aristocrats whom they served, but at the same time they conserved the peaceful and not warlike consciousness of their caste of the province. So they were not peasants, not warriors, not peaceful, not heroic. They were not ruling but serving, and not under rule, working under rule of the other. They were always in the middle. So it was the artificial kind of the social figure that was professional servants with false and splitted consciousness. That is a most important point in the ethno-sociological theory, that the so-called third state that was the main force in the creating of modernity wasn't in the reality third, but that was a demos, an unqualified hybrid construct of the servants. These servants that loved, that liked to be the rulers, but would prefer avoid direct confrontation with death, and at the same time they prefer to rule over the real productors of the goods. So in the society of early modernity, this productive force were as before the peasants. So the bourgeois revolution and modern bourgeois capitalist societies were created artificially by these intermediate group, declared itself without any sufficient reason to be third state, but in the reality being intermediate social group, not third, not second, not first. But that was no type at all, because the servant was insignificant figure in the traditional society. The servant and the demos was a kind of auxiliarity, a kind of accident, something accidental, something not necessary, a kind of something social group that is useful, but that could not have its own rituals, its own special role in the division of the social functions. So they were servants. They could only serve unqualified servants, not being peasants, not being warriors, not being priests. That was the same as cities mob, political mob, and they were in the center of the modernity. If the nation corresponds precisely to these social and historical and ethno-sociological type, because the nation is a kind of chimera, of illusion, of ideological construct created by the demos to include in itself all the other and really qualified social groups. So the nation, the concept of the nation, were directed against first and the second states of the aristocracy, traditional aristocracy of the people. And all the values, all the ideals of the priests, so really, and warriors, were destroyed by the concept of the nation, because the concept of the nation doesn't accept the possibility of the traditional aristocracy. So the nation were created instead of the people, and the modern state was created instead of the traditional state. To be modern, it is the same to be anti-traditional, to be counter-traditional, to be against the traditional society. So religion, the war, the hierarchy, the heroism, the dialogue, direct dialogue with death, all these were put aside, were considered to be a kind of ancient myths that don't deserve any more real attention. And so that was exactly idea to destroy these two first castes, because putting first two first functions of traditional Indo-European society on the same level as the servants, that was the same as to deny for them any kind of social identity. To declare the priest or the aristocrats to be the members of the nation was the same as to humiliate them and to put them on the same level as the servants. And that was bourgeois revolution. That was the reason and the main goal of the bourgeois revolution: to destroy the monarchy, to destroy the church. Church, first caste of Indo-European society; monarchy, or traditional feudal aristocracy, the second caste. So the nation was created in the war against the church and against aristocracy, against monarchy. But at the same time, the nation was created instead of the peasantry and against the peasantry that was living, that continued to live in the kind of ethnic, pre-traditional, pre-people, pre-Laos state of society. Because ethnos in itself doesn't know individual identity. It is holistic. It is the whole in its understanding of the reality. The aristocrats, the first and the second castes of traditional Indo-European society, they have individual identity, identity that is not given as such, but it is a kind of the goal So it is not something that is granted, but it is something that the aristocrat should gain, should obtain in his special heroic life. So it is a process of the individualization and not given individuality. So the meaning of the aristocrat consists precisely in the struggle to be, to become individual. It is not something that is acquired from the beginning. From the beginning is acquired only real possibility to accomplish individualization, but not individuality as such. That is heroic, ascetic, up to the certain level idea of the aristocracy. But that presupposes hard work and a kind of overcoming of himself. So it is a kind of elevation. To rule over the other, you need to elevate above himself. All that is denied by the servants of this intermediate group between second and third castes that try to grasp the power, to take the power in the process of the bourgeois capitalist revolutions. So that was the process directed against the principle of heroic individualization as well as against holistic intra-individual or super-individual identity of the business. So, new kind of identity was born, capitalistic identity that was individualistic one, that refused the bourgeois, the representative of this intermediate social group, refused to undergo the process of the individualization. He refused to become hero. He refused the challenge of death and the struggle of the dead, because the bourgeois is covered by its inner nature. So he prefers avoid. He prefers to avoid death and the direct confrontation with it. But instead of that, he declared that individuality is already acquired. It is a kind of completely unbased pretension, but that was a kind of smartness of bourgeois. Instead of a tragic and heroic struggle with death, to declare that death has already lost. So he is a kind of declared to have, to possess individual immortality. It is not collective immortality of the eternal return of the peasants. It is not the heroic immortality of the priest or the warrior. It is pretended immortality of the coward, smart, aggressive, greedy cohorts that pretend to be a kind of normative figure of the civilization. The nation consists from these cohorts, from these individualities that are completely without any base, completely future, completely nominal. So they are not real individualities. They are pretended individualities, and the nation is formed by such normative types, by bourgeois, and this is directed against heroic individualization of the elites, against church and monarchy, and at the same time against the peasants and holistic, non-individual, shamanic identity, ethnic identity of the masses. So, in French Revolution, we see that the idea of Vendée and the situation of Vendée, where aristocrats, the priests, and the people were united against French revolutionaries that who represented these special social group of bourgeois coming to the power. So all three castes of traditional Indo-European society, the ethnos, the Laos, the aristocrats, the priests, were united in their opposition to the servants that gone out of the control, gone out of their normative and in the reality narrow enough limits of legitimate presence in the society. That was a victory of the Demos over Laos, over ethnos, and that was the revolution of the professional servants, professional cowards, over the masters and the people who produced the goods for material goods and the richness. So very interesting that this new historical class, bourgeois class, that was not caste, that is class or new social group, wasn't initially the group of producers, of productors. They were between the social forces who produced the material goods and masters that used these material products in exchange of the granting the independence and the spiritual horizons for the mass of the population. And all this balance of the traditional society was completely destroyed by the new manifestation of new historical figure of bourgeois. That is the nation. The nation is creation of bourgeois. That is normalization and of this special intermediate social group between second and third caste of traditional Indo-European society, and that could be considered as a purely mechanical extrapolation of these concrete social identity on all other groups and levels of population. So the nation was social construct because imposing a purely individual identity as is normal for bourgeois on all the population, they had fear that society would split immediately, because atomization of the population would produce immediately the effect of absence of any common interests, common goal, and maybe also a kind of chaos, the war of all against all, conceptualized by Thomas Hobbes in his famous Leviathan. So that was that Hobbes called that natural state, because for bourgeois, natural state is the individualistic, egoistic war of the individual against the other, but the war of cowards, not organized heroic war, but the war from behind. It is a kind of the war without rules, without aristocratic spirit of the Greek agon, something completely other. It is burglary. It is something bandits. So that was a kind of bourgeois war, the war of egoist cowards against each other, the worst thing to imagine. So that natural state of war of cowards against cowards, which cowardly means, that was a kind of natural state of bourgeois imagination. And to stop that, they imagined a kind of artificial unity of this dispersed individuals, that was a kind of nation. So for this atomistic and individualistic entities was imposed the idea that are a part of some artificial whole or some structure of some unit, and this unit was expressed, to be understood easier, by the appeal to the glorious past of pretended the same ethnic group in the other historic conditions. So that was a fraud. The nation is a fraud, is a kind of simulacrum of ethnos or simulacrum of people. The nation is completely artificial, created by the demos, and the demos is created around the individual, unqualified individual that normally has nothing to in common with the other individual, so living in natural state. And in the pragmatic reasons to not let all this construction to split immediately, they bourgeois have imagined they need some mean to take all this under control, and they imagined for this reason nation. And Gellner, the other constructivist also with Benedict Anderson developed this idea of artificial nature of nation, stressed important point in his analysis of the nation, that nationalism is not the consequence of the creation of the nation, but is a key, is instrument to create the nation. Nationalism goes first and nation after, because that is the law of the artificiality of the nation. So bourgeois imagine first nationalism, so the idea of something that should unite dispersed citizens of demos, and after applying this nationalism on the, through education, mass information, propaganda, a kind of law and artistic creation and so on, after imposing this nationalism on these naturally dispersed individuals, they have managed to create a kind of simulacrum of ethnic or popular political organization, so nation. So nation is a consequence of the nationalism, and because, and that is, we could not say the same for ethnos or for people, because ethnos is given naturally, historically, the people is created historically by the event of the conquest, and basing on the differences, organic differences between different form of ethno-sociological organization. So that is important moment. The nation is not ethnical and not historical, but political creation and political concept. To apply the idea of nation, national, to other kind of social organization beyond the frame of politic and more precisely modern and bourgeois context is erroneous, is wrong. So we could speak strictly about nation in proper meaning only dealing with the political phenomena, with modernity and with bourgeois capitalist society. Beyond the bourgeois society, beyond modernity, beyond the capitalism, the concept of nation is completely devoid of any concrete ethno-sociological meaning and could represent only a kind of metaphor or erroneously used term. So we have reached in our course to historic phase of modernity, and the nation is something that exists today, because the peoples and traditional society are represented in contemporary only by the traces, fragmentary. There are some ethnic societies, but they live on the periphery of the civilization. And our normative values, our the society we consider to be normative and normal is capitalist, bourgeois, national state society where we live. So we have reached the actuality, but that is very important way that we made to be here, to arrive at this more or less last or near to last point in our exposition of the ethno-sociology. And that is important that we need to differentiate between these three ethno-sociological concepts. Ethnos, that was in prehistorical time and is conserved on the periphery. Laos, that was the main form of social organization during traditional epoch, classical epoch, and the nation, demos, as a main figure of modernity and the basis for creation of society we are living in now.
Okay, in your lecture today, you were talking about the development of the nation as a progression historically, in some sense, from the ethnos, the Laos, or the people during the Middle Ages up on into the nation with modernity. Now, a number of sociological thinkers identify a primary identity particularly in what we might call Western and Central Europe during the Middle Ages as Christendom. And you haven't addressed this at all. Where does the idea of an identity of Christendom, of say someone in the European Middle Ages first identity, primary identity as a Christian first, where does that play in, if at all, into your ethnosociological vision?
So that, because we are speaking of Middle Ages, so we are speaking of traditional society and of the people as the concept of ethnosociology, of the Laos. Laos is has characteristics to be socially stratificated, so to have aristocrats and governed masses, to have or not to have religion, and unity of civilization. We could consider Middle Ages, European Middle Ages as the existence of the Western Christian Laos, Western Christian people that had all three forms. So we had a kind of kingdoms organized on the basis of political power, on the vertical political power, with clear social stratification of the elites or the masses. So, and that was translated in the existence of states, traditional states. So in the Middle Ages we had states. In the Middle Ages we have religion that was unified structure for that was above the states. That was above the states in the Western Europe and with the state in the Eastern Europe, because the concept of Byzantine had a different balance, the idea of different balance between the church and the state.
The Byzantine Empire.
Mm-hmm. So in the Western Europe, the idea of the power, spiritual power of the Pope mm-hmm. was considered to be above states. So the church was above state, but the concept of Christendom could be interpreted by as but the concept of the Christendom could be interpreted as civilizational unity mm-hmm. also, because that was not only the power of the church about the cardinals mm-hmm. and the bishops of any country churches provinces, but that was also the unity of the culture, of the science, of the art, the unity of the language of the Latin that was in the basic uniting form of different European peoples. So we had civilization with the political states and the unity of the church, of religion. So that was exemplary form of coexistence of three main features of the people or Laos as the first derivative of the ethnos of the ethnos in mm-hmm. ethnosociology, and all that was destroyed
of an early form of international society, would you say as well? Christendom as an early form of international society linking
the concept of international society is a kind of creation that start in modernity. So that considered to nation as to be the main unit. Mm-hmm. So maybe it was pre-national society, because civilization is not nation. So civilization unity mm-hmm. Could tolerate different states in the same civilization, mm-hmm. because the borders between traditional states are quite different from the borders between national states. The borders of traditional states were not nearly netly marked. Mm-hmm. They were
transparent. Mm-hmm. So you could go from one stage to the other without noticing it. And that was also for in Russia, in Russian history, that Ivan the Terrible suggested to keep the peasants linked to the earth, mm-hmm. because they too often passed to the Lithuania, and yes. from Lithuania that there was uncontrolled movement that could endanger national security. That was idea, at least not to make the border, but at least to keep the peasants stable, mm-hmm. linked to some concrete place. But because these moving villages were a real problem, a kind of spectrum, a kind of fantastic phantasms mm-hmm. of the villages. You go, you see the village, tomorrow you return, there is no village at all, or something other. And that was quite a sign of Middle Ages, this possibility to go through, to transparency mm-hmm. of the borders, and the free way of circulation of considerable masses of population.
We talked about, you mentioned the artificial nature of the nation and how we could talk about it as being manufactured or as an imagined community. And we mentioned Gellner, Anderson, and probably Smith. As a social constructivist.
Ethno-symbolism of Smith is more sophisticated, mm-hmm. because it is also, it stresses the kind of use of the pre-modern mm-hmm. Concept consciously. So that is a kind
a
of
unity.
Unity, yes.
Primordialism, yes. Yes. So, in this construction of the nation, particularly Anderson talks about the processes of modernity, the printing press, language, universal education, the need to move the peasantry from the countryside to the city, factory labor, and a minimal amount of education needed, and then the creation of national literatures and myths and so on. But he also addresses the factor of violence, in order to create this homogeneous nation states where previously there were multiple ethnos or multiple peoples within one geographic area. There was a process of assimilation with modernity, but there was also an immense amount of violence, and we can characterize this as hundreds of years of fratricidal and genocidal warfare that perhaps only ended with World War II in Europe. So what is the importance of this violence in the creation of the nation state for you?
The nation is the same as the violence, because it is a violence directed against not only ethnic minority, but the nation kills the ethnos. The nation is the kind of organized and conscious genocide and ethnocide. Ethnocide in the sense of the collective identity. It is the process of extermination of the elite, of the aristocracy, at the same time as extermination of the ethnic group of peasant population. So, a war, or special war, nationalistic war, or capitalist bourgeois war, is instrument to impose national borders, national identity, and also we could not consider national language as organic language. It's a kind of idiom. So it is something also artificially created, mm-hmm. because there is not such thing as modern French or modern English or modern Russian, because traditionally in history there were different patois, different form of speaking in different places with many differences, not only in the lexic, but also in the forms, in some special pronunciation, in many other linguistic aspects, and also semantic differences. And all that was killed by the creation of unified artificial language, national language. Because the national language is something that was created as chimera. There was a kind, one of the other form of spoken language, but that was transformed, fixed artificially, and imposed after that through the press, politics, and so on. But that was orientated not only against ethnic minorities speaking the other languages, but also against the majority speaking natural, historical languages instead of this artificial one. So that is very important, that violence, nation is violence, nationalism is always violent, and it goes against the nature of the society, not against the nature of the environment, but also against environment. But nation is antisocial organization of the society, because it destroys all the historic and organic form of social being in the sense of the majority without individual identity, because it is a kind to divide a living body on the parts, because for the peasants the one individual is not human. A human could be considered human only all community. The community is human, it is a big man. So if you separate someone from the community, you devoid him from the meaning, from the content, you devoid him the content of his identity. So he will be considered as invalid, as something partly, it is not human. So it is a kind of social and cultural genocide. Nation is something, and bourgeois society as such, who uses this nationalism in creating itself and imposing itself on the traditional society, always acts using the violence, and always is the same as ethnocide and genocide. The growth of this intermediate social group as demos is typical European phenomenon. We could not explain the reasons of that. Maybe that is a kind of geopolitical destiny, because the West is the land of decline. And if the other society conserve their identity, the land of decline, Abendland, the evening land, is destined to go first in the hell. And I think that the nation is the same as the hell, and bourgeois as form of organization of the infernal society basing on the not human patterns, because this covert and aggressive and individualistic and greedy individuals were a kind of evil imagination, because I consider bourgeois and bourgeois society to be not human at all, because and maybe that that is not the chance that the Greeks and many other ancient tradition they situated the hell to the West. So the West it is a kind of entrance to the hell where the sun declines. So maybe there are the other more scientific explanations for the same particularity of the history, but that is the fact that the transformation of this society from the traditional society into the nation is typically European phenomenon. And it was exactly as you have said, it was repeated in the other part of the world only by the pressure of the West, or in some reason you have quite right pointed out, for defensive reason in the case of Japan or Russia. But that was also imposed in some way. Imposed. And finally, nor Japan, not Russia, and Russia more obviously, are not complete nations, much more traditional society. For example, ethnic plurality of the Russian society is the living example of in existence of the modern nation in Russia.
So yes, so we see that perhaps that in some states today, in nation states in the world today, that this there's a thin veneer of a nation state, but because of the multiple existing ethnicities and identities within them, particularly Russia, and some of the other states, Iran, some of the others, that this, and but even more so, Africa, South America, this nation state lies very loosely, does not fit well.
Absolutely. If we consider, for example, the borders in Africa, they don't correspond to anything because they divide the people, the tribes, the ethnic, the religious, cultural, natural entities without any consideration of their nature. So they, as well as I think that any modern nation, by different reasons, is quite a failure, a failed national state. All existing national states are failed by different reasons. Some of them are not enough modernized, and that is the reason why they are failed, because they are not complete nation. For example, Iran or Russia or China are not nations, are something more or something different.